to worship tonight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Well, we're welcoming our online audience, those in the building. Come on, let's take a moment of worship before the word of God comes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, the worshiper in me wants to be free from the cares of life that seem to weigh me down. Yes, the worshiper in me needs consistency to lift my hands and give you praise when no one's around. Yes, the worshiper in me wants to break free from the intellectual mentality. Like when I should be up, I'm seated in my seat. I should be lifting my hands, giving you praise and glory. I give you more. More, I give more. Yes, more, I give more. More, yes, I give you more. More, come on, can we say that again? Oh, the worshiper in me wants to be free from the cares of life that seem to weigh me down. Oh, the worshiper in me needs consistency to lift my hands and give you praise when no one's around. Oh, the worshiper in me wants to break free from this intellectual mentality. When I should be up, I'm seated in my seat. I should be lifting my hands, giving you praise and glory. I give you more, more. Yes, I give you more, more. I give you more, more. I give you more.
Let's just sing that to the Lord. Everybody say, I want to give you, I want to give my best to you. If you're at home watching, sing it. I want to go wherever you say, say the word. Oh, baby, I want to live a life that's real. I want to serve you, Lord, for real. For you deserve all this and more. I give you more. Hallelujah. I give you more. Right where you are, Father, we honor you for this moment. We don't take a moment for granted. And as we are gathered together in your presence, I pray that you would change us in your presence. And when we are changed, we will strengthen our brother and our sister. Satan, we serve you notice tonight that every contract is canceled, all agreements are broken. We command you to loose God's sons, to let his daughters go free. Arrest our attention tonight. Let the power of your word come into our hearts. Let your revelation knowledge be revealed to us. And I pray for even those that are watching now, wherever they are, that they will hear your voice. That they will hear your words. And tonight, because of your word, you will cause us to live. In Jesus' name, amen. Clap your hands and praise him. Clap your hands and praise him. Come on, clap your hands and praise the Lord tonight. Clap your hands and praise him. How many are glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Isn't it good to be here? Amen. Clap your hands and praise God one more time for being here. Oh, man, I'm telling you, last week I was so looking forward to being here in the sanctuary. And we had a major snowstorm, so we started this series from our living room. I'm so glad to be in the house of God tonight. And I'm grateful for all that he's done and all that he is. I honor all of our leadership. Your respective places, I honor God. Thank God for being saved and sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. I thank God for the goodness of the Lord and his mercies. The mercies of the Lord are new every day. How many are glad about the mercies of God? Amen. God bless each and every one of you. So glad you're here. I want to welcome our online audience, those of you that are joining us virtually across the country, around the world, wherever you may be joining us, I want you to take this opportunity to say hello. Let me know that you're on. Let me know where you're joining in from. Perhaps you're outside of the state of Illinois. Let me know where you're sharing from. If you're with OLC, check in and let me know that you're here. We are here. We are back every Wednesday night. We'll be teaching and ministering and sharing out of the word of the Lord. It's a time of learning, instruction, and understanding. And so I want you to make your way to the house of God. If at all be possible, be here on Wednesday nights as we experience what God is doing. And I'm just grateful. God bless each and every one of you. God is incredibly kind to us. Thank God for all of his grace and his mercy. If you're watching on YouTube, like what you're watching. Subscribe to the channel so that you can be alerted when powerful content is emanating from Overcomers Life Church. And here, and on YouTube, if you can, hit the notification bell. And when you hit the notification bell, then that way you'll be alerted that we are sharing word from the house of the Lord. And so, I'm grateful for all of his goodness and all of his grace and all of his mercy. Amen. God bless you, Sister Rena. So same thing right there. So hello everybody. Hey, what's up, y'all? And then if you're virtual, what's up? Y'all say hello. Y'all make sure y'all say hello. And those of you that are in the audience, if you see some of your OLC family join in online, say hello to them. And let them know that you know, just say what's up to them. Amen. God is good. So we are in part two. We are in installment number two of this teaching series. You understand that on Sundays, we, you know, it's an opportunity for us to proclaim the gospel of Christ and to have the worship experience that sets our week on fire. And here on Wednesday nights is our opportunity to dig a little deeper in the Word of God. Because the more you know about the Word of God, is the more you can access from God. So the more word you know, the more revelation about God's word you know, the more you can access from what he's saying to us. And I want us to dive into the word of God. I do want to alert you, those of you as well, that are viewing us, there's always opportunities for the entire family on every Wednesday night too, as well. Installment number two of the teaching series, Honor God with the First, or What Do You Do with the First? What do you do with the first? What if every one of your days, what if every day began with you giving God the first 7 minutes of your day? Before anything else, before we put our hand to device to check our media and email, before we scramble eggs, or before we do anything significant, what if the first 7 minutes of your day was given to God? What if when you analyze your finances, your household finances, and you looked at your money, and you looked at your bills, and you looked at all of the things that you have going on financially and the gaps and the needs that you have, what if you made the intentional choice to put God first in your finances, not last, or not as an afterthought? What if in your relationships, instead of being led by your emotions, that we put God first in our relationship? How do you do that? Your acknowledgement, your request of direction, you asking God for what you need in that particular situation. What if we put God first in our relationship? What about your ministry assignment? I know it's ministry, it would seem that God should be first. But how many know sometimes other things get in the way of sincere and true ministry? What if we put God first in our ministry? Whatever assignment that God has given us, what if we placed Him first? What about your business? Or whether you are have an employer or you have your own business, what if before you operated in that role that day, or that you perform your duties that day, that you honored God and asked Him to direct you and to lead you and to give you what to say and how to say? What if you put God first in your business and not the money? How much more different would our lives be, or even the success of our lives be, if we simply put God first? Because we've already laid the foundation, even on last week, that what you do with the first will determine how God blesses the rest. How you honor God with the first of a thing will determine what God will do with the rest of a thing. There is a power in the first. There is an anointing about what you do impartation on the firstborn, because it was something about the first. It was something about what you do with the first that honors God. The great commandment of God is that you love the Lord your God, and Him only shall you serve. Loving God with all of your heart, mind, and strength, your soul, that is literally putting God first. This is what worship is all about. Thou will have no other gods before me. It's priority. It's placement. It's what's first. And if you really consider some of the most confusing, perplexing, dangerous times in your life, quite possibly, may have been times where we did not put Him first. I hope there's some truth to that statement. I believe it is. That when we don't put God first, make Him priority, that other things seem to be out of alignment. What you do with the first will determine how God blesses the rest. Let's go a little bit deeper. Because our key to what we experience with God, and I believe God is getting ready to take us to an even greater space. Every year, every day of your life, there are levels in God that you can continue to reach. Places in God that you can continue to access. And God is saying, I want you to access them. It is done by the Word of God. One of the things that God wants us to see is that what we experience in Him has a lot to do with learning how to actively obey God in everyday life. I spent some time thinking about this because we often talk about obeying God. I don't think anybody in here would be bold enough to say that they won't obey God. Right? I think we have a heart to obey God. So the issue is not necessarily for many of us our desire to obey. What then becomes the issue is how do you actively obey every day? So if I say to you, obey God and watch God work for you, then you need to know, what does it mean to actively obey God in your everyday life? There's got to be a merging of obedience in our everyday life and the instruction from God. So this is where our relationship becomes paramount and important with God, because as He's giving you the Word of God, as you're reading the Word of God, your life and your mind is being transformed to actively carry out what you are receiving and hearing in your spirit. That's the obedience of God. The more you do that is the more you obey, and the more you obey, the more access to the things of God you get. Our key to what we experience from God is how we actively obey Him in everyday life. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19. Because when we talk about what you do with the first, it's all about doing. Doing is in obedience. Acting is in obedience. Isaiah 1, 19. Here it is. It's two things here. If you are willing and obedient, then He says, I'm going to let you eat the good of the land. I'm going to give you access to things that people will try and work 80 hours a week for. He says, I need you to do two things. I need you to be willing, and I need you to be obedient. The word willing, there, it is a Hebrew word, shama. It means consenting to, agreeing with. Your willingness is an agreement with what He said. If we are going to move in obedience, it has to start with our agreement about what God is saying. Many times God is speaking to us and allowing for us to obey, but we don't agree with what He said yet. Oh, glory to God. Do you not know people have hindered their literal blessings because they had not agreed with the principle of the time. What's hindering your release is your agreement with the principle. Some of us are doing it outside of agreement. You've got to agree that this is what God is saying about this space. God's agreement. The agreement of the Word of God. Coming to agreement with what He's saying. That's even true when God convicts you about something. Anybody ever been convicted by the Word of God before? If you've been saved long enough, if you have the real Holy Spirit within you, something should convict you about your life. I'm scared of a believer that's never convicted about anything. If you do wrong and you keep going on and the Holy Spirit does not convict you, you don't have the Holy Spirit.
Oh, God, that was tough.
Now, I didn't say that you obeyed the Holy Spirit. I said if you never hear the Holy Spirit convict you about it, because the Bible clearly says that the Holy Ghost, when He has come, He is the Spirit of truth. And He will lead you and guide you into all truth. And if you are not convicted by the Holy Spirit when you do wrong, I question your Holy Ghost.
Oh, God, help me. I'm getting in trouble.
Because people of God, the Holy Spirit, I didn't say condemn. I said convict. We should be convicted about some things. The conviction brings us into agreement with what He said. That's what conviction does. That's what conviction does. It says, God, I agree with what You have said about my life. Honestly, sometimes it takes us hearing it 3 or 4 times before we realize. Do you remember when Jesus told Peter that before the cock crow twice, you were going to deny me 3 times? He's like, no, Jesus, I'm not going to do that. It's not going to be me. I'll never leave you. I'll never do anything like that. Oh, yes, sure enough. Here it is. Peter found himself when Jesus was arrested. They saw Peter. He said, you look like one of those. Peter said, that's not me. No, it ain't. He said, yes, it is. Peter said, no, it's not. They said, your speech betray you. You talk different. Peter went to cussing. And when the cock crowed, when he heard it, he began to weep. Because it was then he had realized the conviction of the Holy Spirit had set in that he had disobeyed God. He had missed the mark. We should have an agreement, that conviction, to the Word of God. We should have a desire to be forever changed by the Word of God. And there are some things you can't sit on all your life. Oh, God, help me here. You're wondering why you can't get free. Because you're sitting on something that God has convicted you about that you won't deal with. There are some things that God convicts you about only requires you to say, Lord, I'm sorry, and keep moving. But there are other things you're supposed to deal with. And you sweep it under the rug because nobody's going to notice it. But the more you sweep it under the rug, you know what they say happened after a while? You're going to trip on that rug. There are times where we need to, and don't it feel good to just get it out of your heart? My God. Anybody ever been there before? There are some things you carry weight unnecessarily. If you be willing, come into agreement with what God is saying, here it is, and obedient. Let me rehearse the word obedient. It is obedient is the shama word. Willing is the consenting word, but shama, let me back that up, is obedience. Now, that word means, so when you word is the obedience word. The consenting word is willing. Now, the obedient word, it literally means to hear intelligently. It means to hear with attention. So the way we obey God is what we hear from God. But it's a hearing intelligently. It is a spiritual discernment of what God is saying for you to do. Anybody ever just knew God wanted you to do a thing and you didn't hear it in actual words? Because it's a spiritual intelligence. It is a spiritual hearing about what God is saying. This is the way you should go. This is what you should do. This is how you should do it. And when God gives that to you, he said, if you are consenting in agreement with what I'm saying and you're hearing me intelligently, you're going to eat the good of the land. Oh, God said, I have some good things for you, but it's about your obedience. What you hear is important. What you hear is important. Because the word, the good of the land, the good means the joy of the land, the beauty of the land. It means property. It means good things. There is a canvas of God's blessing and miracle waiting on you if you come into agreement with what he said and you hear him intelligently to respond. Everybody say, be obedient. Because your response with what you do with the first is directly connected to your obedience. Obey God with it. Now, this covers so many different areas, but we have to obey God with our life. Obey God with our finances. Obey God in our relationship. Oh, God, help me here. Put God first. I'm getting ready this year to deal with marriages. I'm going there this year. I'm going to deal with marriages this year because the enemy is trying to destroy marriages. He always has, but I see it. I see it. I see it arising in such a destructive way. Well, he's trying to destroy it, but it does not surprise me because the closer you get to the return of Christ is the more marred and scarred the concept of marriage becomes, because everything about marriage is everything about Christ to the church. And as ugly as he can make it look, as bad as the enemy can make it look, that's what he wants. But I'm coming for you this year. Oh, yeah, I'm coming for you. I'm coming for you this year because God wants our marriages to thrive. But how many know we've got to obey God in that? We've got to obey God in our relationships. We have to obey God in our finances. We've got to respond to God. Because the question of obedience, as we said last time, will test your heart. It will test where your heart is. Because the scripture says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The things that you value, your treasure, there will your heart be also. Where you place value at, where you deposit wealth to, the place of precious things collected and laid up in the coffers, the storehouse, the repository, collected treasures, where those things are, there will your heart be also. You got to look at this. Because this is what God said. We have to look at this. We have to look at this. We have to look at this. Your time can be your treasure. Your attention can be your treasure. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Your money is your treasure. Your gifting is your treasure. Your gifting is your treasure. Remember, we have these treasures in earthen vessels. Or jars of clay, your gifting can be your treasure. Where are you lending your gift to? Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I was in a place and I was thinking in my mind, I said, boy, I'm listening to some people right now, and they're going to be doing worship on Sunday. And it was Saturday. It wasn't that worshiping to me. But I'm thinking, man, they're going to be up leading us in worship. Sunday because people don't value the gift. Don't value the gift. Do you not know we got a sickness in the church? We got a sickness in the church. We got secular leaders who want to be worship leaders too. I ain't saying you can't be that. I just said pick one. That's all I'm saying. I'm just saying pick one. Which one you going to be? You going to lead me in worship or you going to lead me to the bed? So y'all act like that music can't lead you to the bed. I'm asking you to pick one. Because if I'm trying to be led to the bed, then I might play you. That's me and my wife's business. We ain't ratchet, we just holy. I can't help it because I was raised in the 90s. We got the best R&B music ever. We can argue later. But if I'm ready to be led into worship, I don't need Brian McKnight. You ain't gonna talk to me here. Sometimes, in many cases, we have devalued our treasures. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I'm gonna say this. I'm gonna get stones thrown or not. But if the Holy Spirit looked at your account transactions, you might discover a whole lot about you. But will we discover where your treasure is? Because God is requiring us. He's requiring us to make Him first. What do you do with the first? Why? Here it is. It's interesting because God says, Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. Y'all doing all right? Okay. I got a time that I got to stop. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. It was always interesting to me that Jesus presented it this way. It always boggled me. It's so interesting. It's so presented in an interesting way that many times it's always misquoted. That's how interesting the presentation of it is. Because you think it should be something else. Matthew 6:24, it says, no man, as man or woman, can serve two masters. For either he will, that's a strong word, hate the one. Now listen, look, Jesus is saying there's no gray area here. He says, you either, well, can I just like and love? No. Jesus didn't say that. Either you're going to hate the one. Now, you can go and pull up whatever definition of hate you want. Read that one, and that's what he's saying. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or if he would hold to the one, cling to it, and despise the other. Here's a statement of truth. You cannot serve God and man. The interesting thing about this presentation of truth is often misquoted because your first mind thinks that it should say, you cannot serve God and man. But that's not what he said. He said what he said on purpose. The word mammon is not the word for man. The word mammon is the word for riches and wealth and money and the world system of money. Mammon. A wealth, riches, system of the earth. What Jesus is saying is, why did he use mammon? Why didn't he say man? Because if you want to be controlled by something, let your money control you. He says the indicator, oh God, He says the indicator of how you actually are responding for real, not what you say, is which one are you serving? Are you serving your money or are you serving your God? See, because there's a whole lot of stuff you can take from people that say, until they mess with your money. Like, you ain't gonna let nobody mess with your money. They mess with your money, then that's when you got a problem. Some of y'all ready to fight? Quit and cuss. If they mess with your money. So God says, forget the man. I know what runs the man. Because he said, the love of it is at the root of all evil anyway. That's your motivation for evil, is the love of that money. He says, I want to find out how you really feel about me. Oh, God, help me. He says, do you serve money or do you serve me? That's why some people can't serve the church unless they get a check. I ain't talking about none of y'all. I said some people. Because what? That's why God, he loves to do it. Before he brings you into a harvest, he will always put you in a place of service to test your heart. Can you do it without your hands stuck out? Can you do it? Can you do it without faking humility and really in the contract after they should have paid me? Y'all ain't gonna talk to me in here. You cannot serve. I'm not talking about taking advantage of people. I'm talking about knowing where your heart is. Because you can't serve God and the system and the money and the wealth. So God says, what you do with the first. That's what he's trying to get you to see. Where you place your priority at. How do you place God first in your money, in your family, in your relationships, in your ministry? Because you can't serve either. You gonna love one and despise the other. You gonna hold on to one. The rich young ruler said, Jesus, what can I do to be with you? What do I need to do? I fast twice a day. I take care of everything. Jesus said, I got you. Let me test your heart. Go sell everything you got and give it to the poor. He knew what would test him. He said, I don't care about your religion. I don't care how often you come to church. He said, it doesn't matter to me that you fast twice a week. It doesn't matter that you're the most faithful person in the church. It don't even matter to me. I'm always there. Go sell what you have and give it to me. He despised Jesus because the Bible says he walked away of a sorrowful heart because he couldn't part with his money. Because Jesus knew what was going to test your heart. Glory to God. How many of us have failed the test? How many of us did not intelligently hear when God told you to move, when God told you to bless, when God told you to sow? You keep running into a ceiling and a brick wall because you have not intelligently heard. Your spirit has ignored God's instruction of obedience. And until you are consenting in agreement and in obedience with his word, you cannot eat of the good of the land. What will you do with the first? See, because now we got an individual choice to make. Pastor ain't gonna see your bank book. No. Nobody's gonna see. Oh, God, help me here. Okay, because there are some people who just want to fake you out. But they're really not serving God. They'll say boastfully what they'll do. Never had a heart to do it. You can't serve God and serve is who will control you. That's who will control you. That's who you'll be led by. All right, let me keep going. Okay, so that brings me to this, and I'm going to start this. We'll finish it next week, but I'm going to start this. That brings me into the principle of the first fruit. I'm going to deal with it a little bit. It brings me to the principle of the first fruit. The first fruit is different than the tithe. The tithe is the principle of obedience as well with your finances and what you give. But the first fruit is a little different because it's talking about how we honor God with the first of a thing. I want you to look at the book of Leviticus. If you read the book of Leviticus, we'll go to Leviticus chapter number 23. If you really study out the book of Leviticus, it is a book of how God sets things in order, how he creates a Levitical order of things that the way he wants worship to be handled, the way he wants people to come before him, the instruction, the set of behaviors and actions, and how we approach God. Leviticus structures that. So because we're looking at the Old Testament, what you really want to see is when you read Leviticus, what you're getting a glimpse of is how God likes to move. See, when you really get deep into a relationship, you start learning the other person's behaviors. You start kind of learning, like, kind of how they move a little bit. You can get ahead of them because you know they like that. Okay? So, oh, man. Okay, so, here we go again. Oh. So here it goes. So my beautiful wife. So she was dropping me off somewhere, and I had my things in my space, and she was to come back a little bit later, and so but in my space, in my room, I had some cookies in my room. I had some cookies in my room, and she knew they were there, and so we were outside. She pulled up. She's gonna take off. Her kids are going. They're coming back later. I'm going in. She pulls up. She gets ready to get out. I'm getting out the car. See you later, baby. See you later. And she says, "It's cold outside, right?" I wish I knew that. And so she says, "Can you go in? And can you bring me a cookie?" And I'm like, "You in the car. It's cold. I'm going in. Won't you go ahead? Why I gotta go in and come back out for a cookie?" And so I'm like, "Okay, if you really want this cookie, send David or Tyler in. They can bring you the cookie back out." And I didn't get the response I thought I was going to get. She's looking at me like, I'm like, it's the same amount of time. Whether I bring the cookie or they bring the cookie, it don't matter. Where the brother's at? So, oh, God, I may need to be in my own marriage boot camp. So this is what I did. I said, "Tyler, come on, man. See, I'm coming back here." Me and Tyler went in the room. "Come on, Tyler." We went in there. I think it was Tyler or David. Who went? Tyler went. We went in. Looked at some cookies. Something told me. I have some intelligent hearing. Something told me you better walk them cookies out. I picked up some cookies out of you. Came back out the room. Walked walked out to the door. And I said, here's your cookies. And I seen a little smile crack on the corner of her beautiful lips. Because not only did I say, here, I said, I'm going to take one, you take the rest. See, because when you're really in relationship, you want to know how somebody moves. What makes them tick? What's gonna make it right? Because sometimes it ain't what you think it is. Oh, God, help me here. I'm almost done. So if it's true for us, when we read Leviticus, what we get ready to find out is what makes God tick. What does he like? See, it ain't about being literal. It's about understanding how God moves. This is his behaviors. This is God's tendencies. So when I started reading Leviticus and I read about first fruit, I said, it ain't about necessarily the feast. It's about his tendencies. What makes him move? And it taught me that giving him the first. I only got 2 minutes. So Leviticus chapter 23, God introduces, I want to show you something. He introduces 8 feasts. There's many feasts of Jerusalem, of the Jewish people, but there are 8 feasts that are of critical importance. Let me show you why. Chapter 23, Leviticus, number 1, it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel. That's in verse 2. And say unto them, concerning, watch this, here it is, the feast of who? This ain't got nothing to do with nobody else. This ain't the feast of Esther, because there is a feast for Esther, of the Purim, when Esther went in to present herself and saved all of the Jewish people. There's a feast for that. But that ain't in these feasts. These are the feasts of God. If you, the Lord, or better translated, Jehovah, the eternal God. See, oh God, help me here. Because notice, it didn't say these are the feasts of God. Oh, God, watch this. It didn't say these are the feasts of God. The Bible says these are the feasts of Jehovah, of the Lord. Why? Because Jehovah is God revealed. See, oh, God, you can know God and don't know Jehovah. That's why. Why did God have to introduce himself to Moses? Because he wasn't just introducing God. He was introducing, I am that I am. Jehovah, the eternal one. Because Jehovah is God revealed. So when God is revealed, that's when you get Jehovah Jireh. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me in here. That's when you get not just God, you get Jehovah Nisi, my victory. That's when you get Jehovah Shalom, my peace. These are the feasts, not just of God. These are the feasts that get you in a place where you see him as Lord. So they had 8 of them. Oh God, I don't have time to teach it. The first one was the weekly Sabbath feast. We call it worship. It's the Lord's. That's why you don't treat Sunday worship any kind of way. In the old covenant, that Sabbath was on a Saturday. We understand this. But I told you, we're not talking literal, we're talking principle. See, because every day became a Sabbath for worship. And when Jesus rose from the grave early the first day of the week, all of a sudden, Sunday became a high worship day. So he says, the weekly feast is the Sabbath feast. It's mine. That's why the pastor is the priest of the house. And when he brings order to the house, that's because he is responsible. sure that worship that belongs to God is in order. So if you get rebuked because of worship, that's my job. You ain't going to talk to me in here. You don't have to like it. You can be mad at me. But if it's about me putting order in worship, get out of the way. I'd rather be in line with God than to be in line with you. That's why you can't let anybody do anything in the worship service. That's why you can't let the worship be led by money and filthy lucre. That's why you can't let people get up and run anything in the service, because I am managing what belongs to the Lord. I wish y'all get it and stop thinking worldly. I wish people get it and stop. No, the reason why I have to do what I have to do, because I am managing what belongs to Him. And if I see mess, I got to call it out. And if I see junk, I got to call it out. I don't need your permission to call it. I don't need your okay to call it. I don't need you to write me a letter to give me consent to say it. I don't even have to have your permission to have a revelation about it. If God says get it in order, God says it's my worship, get my worship in order. That's why you got a lot of pastors who have been removed. They were afraid to get it in order. God says, concerning the feast of second feast is the Passover feast. Y'all know what it's about. Why is it so important now? Because Jesus became our Passover lamb. Woo-wee! Honor Him. Now the Passover feast was a yearly feast. And then that was the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Oh, glory to God. Then you have the yearly Feast of the Pentecost. That's why the Holy Spirit always has to be paramount in your worship. Then that was the yearly Feast of the Trumpets. That was the yearly Feast of the Atonement, of the sacrifices of your sins. That was the yearly Feast of the Tabernacle. And then that was the number four Feast of the text was the yearly Feast of the First Fruits. Oh, glory to God. It was the yearly Feast of the First Fruit. And He says, tell the church, He says, when they come into the land which I give unto them. Watch this. This is the principle of the first fruit. I'm almost done. When you come into the harvest I promised you. This is first fruit. Not this, your tithe you do all the time. When you come into what you beg me for. When you come into what you laid before me, asking me for, when I bring you into your harvest, before you do anything with it, He says, take some of it, a sheaf of the first fruit of your harvest, and take it to the priest. Oh, y'all don't like me in here. He says, and the priest is going to wave it before the Lord. To be accepted on Sunday. It says, on the morrow after the Sabbath. In other words, God says, every time you come into the harvest of what you prayed for, He says, bring me the first of it. Because if you want to know how to get God to move and honor Him with the first, let us stand. I got to finish next time. Let us stand. Watching, get ready. I told you all before, here it is. Lift your hands if you can. I told you all that the more revelation you know about God is, the more you can get from God. Because we intelligently respond in hearing to His word. Father, I praise you. You have sent your holy word, and you have spoken. And I pray, oh God, that our hearts and our minds are forever molded and changed because of the power of this revelation. And that this truth will be the principle to which we live. And I pray, God, that the revelation of the first will begin to stir in us, causing us to put you first in every area of our lives. And as you bring us into our promised harvest, we honor you. Because we will not serve the system of the world, but we choose to serve you. We will cling to you. We will hold to you. God, if you convict us, we say yes. If you correct us, we say yes. If you instruct us, we say yes. If you give us word to obey, we yield. And we pray it in the name of Jesus. Let your worship be your first tonight. Open your mouth and give it to God. Come on, give it to God. Don't give them no leftovers. Don't give them no leftovers. Give them the first. Come on, give them the first. Give them the first. Give them the fruit of your lips. Glory to God. Somebody shout glory. Now clap your hands everywhere and praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many, when you come into your harvest, you know what to do with it? How many know? When you come into your harvest, because your harvest ain't the size of your seed. When you come into the thing that was bigger than what you sowed, move on. What you targeted your seed for, what you prayed for, when you come into that, give God the first of it. It's called first fruit. In other words, the production of the fruit came, but out of the fruit, I'm going to give you the first of the fruit. Your tithe may have been your seed, but that ain't your harvest. When you get your harvest, give God one of those apples. Hallelujah. Let's sow our seed tonight. If you're watching me online, I challenge you to sow a $20 gift tonight. I challenge everyone in the room to sow a $20 gift tonight. Others may be challenged to do more. Sow tonight. I believe God. I believe God. I believe God. I believe God. There's a number of ways you can give. I believe God. I challenge you to sow tonight. Sow your $20 seed. God is bringing us into, hallelujah, a wealthy place. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I break that spirit of lack off your life. Like you've been in a rut for a couple of months. I break that spirit of lack off your life in Jesus' name. You're watching me online. You're sowing right now. You heard the word of God. You're moving in obedience to that word. Even now. Even now. Begin to sow from everywhere. You're giving electronically. I break that spirit of lack. I break that spirit of poverty. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, what we are believing God for, it shall, it will, it must come to pass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It shall, it will, it must come to pass. It shall, it will, it must. We know how God moves, how he ticks, how he operates. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Father, thank you for those that have given 100-fold return. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. If you're online, continue to give. If you're sowing, you're online, just type the words, I'm sowing. Type the words, I'm sowing. Can't wait to meet you all here on Sunday, you all. Sunday. We have come through the month of January, and we have been in revival and being refreshed and focused and refocused. And we have come through a capital campaign, and now we're going to set our attention and our focus on the worship of the Lord and evangelism. Now we turn our focus here. We have time to prepare for our second leg of our campaign, but now we turn our focus for the worship of the Lord and evangelism. Pray that God would allow you to win the soul. Pray that God would allow as to whom to invite. Lift up your gift and they'll come serve you. Whom to invite. I'm inviting those that are watching me right now. Get to the house of God. Get to the house of God. Don't be late on your movements. The world is going on right now. So we're not going to be behind. Glory to God. Let's get to the house of God. Let's get to the house of God. Let's make our way to the house of God. It ain't going to be like that anymore. Make your way to the house of God. Make your way to the house of God. house of God. Let's be here at 9:30 a.m. as we feed on the teaching of our Sunday school life class, and then we're prepared mentally and ready to go for worship at 11 a.m. That's going to be a powerful move of God. We'll be preaching a message that you don't want to miss. We'll be preaching from the series Lessons from the Cave. Hallelujah. 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 And God is doing amazing things for us. Oh, I'm ready, you all. Thank God. Thank God for the goodness of the Lord. Isn't God good to us? Those of you that have joined us online, thank you so much again. I appreciate you. God keep you. God bless you, my friend. God bless each and every one.